For the last 4 years, I've been documenting my journey to create and release my first indie game, Farewell North, and one of the most common questions on every video is how I created the color mechanic. Now that Farewell North is out, I figure it's time to finally show you just how simple this effect actually is. If you're not already familiar, in Farewell North you can activate special objects in the world to create a color source. These can be carried or they might move on their own, and when they hit other objects they can create chain reactions or carve out dark shadows, and when you complete an island you permanently restore color to the entire area. This effect also serves as a pretty decent introduction to shaders, so if you're one of the many aspiring game devs who's afraid of shaders or you always wondered how they work, don't worry, this should help alleviate some fears. The basic idea is super simple. Whenever we're rendering something, say a blade of grass, we just need to know whether it's within a color source or not, and either return the normal colored value or some special uncolored value. But what does uncolored mean? In Farewell North this got really complicated, probably more complicated than the actual coloring logic, and it relied on blending gradients, object types, lighting and textures to create a readable, stylized world. But that's all art direction and probably not what you want for your own game, so for this example we'll just go with a super basic desaturation by taking the final color and averaging its RGB channels. And that's the basic idea, but how do we actually implement this? There are a few ways you could achieve this effect. Most people seem to assume that it's a screen space post-processing effect, meaning we essentially render the fully colored scene into an image, and then run a shader on that final image to implement the desaturation for areas that are uncolored, much like you would in something like Photoshop. That is certainly possible, but there are a few reasons why I didn't go this route. Since this mechanic is the central hook of my game, and throughout the game I knew there were going to be many cases where color behaves in slightly different ways, I wanted to have very fine-grained control over every aspect of the effect. To give just one example, think about this image where the same pixel represents both water and the sand beneath it. If all we have is an image, how do we decide if this pixel's in color? The water is at one position, colored in this case, and the sand is at another position, uncolored. If all we have is a rendered scene and perhaps a depth buffer, we still only know about the position of either the water or the sand. The solution would probably be to remove the effect from the transparent objects and make the water opaque, but that's kind of lame. We're also going to have objects that appear or disappear based on whether they're in color, which just isn't feasible in a screen space effect, effectively ruling it out for such a central game mechanic. Instead, we're going to implement this directly into the main shading pass. This could potentially be more expensive than doing it in screen space, but again, it's the central hook of the game and it's worth the cost. Besides, the effect isn't terribly expensive and we'll go through some optimizations later. So let's do this, let's recreate the effect from scratch. Farewell North is created in Unity, but the implementation is exactly the same in any engine with shaders, and I've been meaning to check out Godot, so I think I'll recreate it there. But first, how do I use Godot? Thankfully, I found plenty of Godot classes on Skillshare to get me started. Oh, you guys don't know about Skillshare? Well, that's perfect, because they're the sponsor of today's video. Skillshare is the largest online learning community for creatives with thousands of classes led by industry experts. When you're making a game, there's so much to learn, and Skillshare provides classes across game design, animation, 3D modeling, illustration, and so much more. When you get started, you'll be asked about your interests, and from there, Skillshare immediately surfaces recommendations tailored to your goals. I recommend diving into their learning paths, which are a great way to pick up all the skills you need to take your skills to the next level. Personally, I've been learning Godot with the introduction to 3D game development in Godot class to get up to speed to create this effect. But I'm also using Skillshare to pick up some proper character animation skills from industry experts. You guys know I am not a strong animator, and it's been a big limiting factor for me. With the back-to-school fall vibes and a bit of downtime after releasing Farewell North, I figure it's the perfect time to level up my animation skills before I get started on my next game. So I'm exploring the build 3D models and animations with Blender learning path to get more comfortable with animations and improve my skills. I've also always wanted to learn how to draw, so I've got my eye on Drawing for Beginners as my next class to dive into. Thank you so much to Skillshare for sponsoring this video. The first 500 people to use my link in the description will receive a 1 month free trial of Skillshare so you can start learning shaders, game development, animation, or dive into something totally new. So make sure to check the description and follow the link to get started today. Now that I'm feeling more comfortable with Godot, I've got a little demo scene set up that we can use to recreate the color effect. The first thing we need to do is set up a basic shader that can implement the color desaturation for our uncolored world. We start with a basic colored world shading, just sampling a texture. This is where you would normally do all your lighting calculations, but we're just going to keep it super simple. This is looking more or less the same, so now we can come up with our uncolored world. We can create a very simple grayscale effect by simply averaging the RGB channels from the colored value, and then assigning that average back into the RGB channels. Now the world's grayscale. Cool. So we just need to decide if our current pixel should be colored or not by checking if it's in range of any color sources. We'll use a basic shape to represent our color source. A sphere, which is simply a position and a radius, can be neatly packed into a vector 4. If the current pixel position is in range of that sphere, then we're colored, otherwise we're uncolored. We'll use an SDF to perform this check. SDFs are signed distance functions, which simply means a function that returns a signed distance to a shape. Signed distance means that the distance can be positive or negative, where a negative value means that it's inside of the shape, and a positive value means it's outside of the shape, in this case a sphere. SDFs are super useful, and there's a rather ubiquitous source for SDF shader definitions that you can find here. Spheres are really the simplest 3D shape, with the SDF being the distance minus the radius. But there are other formulas for other shapes which grow in complexity if you're interested. Anyways, let's implement our sphere SDF. For now, I'm just going to use a hard-coded sphere at 000 at the world origin, and a radius of 3. But we'll make this all move based on objects in the game world shortly. If the distance is greater than the radius, then we'll get a positive value indicating how far the position is from the sphere's edge, and if the distance is less than the radius, we'll get a negative value, also indicating how far the position is from the sphere's edge, but inside the sphere. Now we can check the sign distance to our current pixel. If the result is negative, then we're inside the sphere and we're in the colored world, and we should use the colored world value. Otherwise, we're in the uncolored world, and we should use the uncolored value. And suddenly we have the effect. It's a bit tricky to see though, so let's add a border to the sphere. Since we have the sign distance to the sphere, we can add another check when we're outside of the sphere to see if the distance is less than an edge width, say 0.1. If so, let's render the current pixel as white, and now we have a nice edge around the color. Pretty! We only have one color source though, and it's hard-coded, so now let's apply these from the CPU side so we can actually make some gameplay. For Farewell North, I defined a global array of color sources, but unfortunately Godot doesn't support global shader arrays, so we'll have to define a whole bunch of vector4s, one by one. I guess that's my first Godot feature request. From the CPU side, we need a class to represent our color sources, so we can attach them to objects in the world. The color source simply has a radius, and its transform contains the position, and we can add a pack function to pack it all up into a vector4. Next, I've created a color manager script which has an array of color sources. Each frame, it packs them all up and supplies them to the shader as global values, along with an integer saying how many active color sources we actually have. Back in our shader, we'll invent our own sign distance function to return the sign distance to color. But what does that mean? Well, it's simply the sign distance to the nearest color source. We can quickly run through all the active color sources and find the minimum sign distance and return that. We just plug in the new color SD function instead of the hard-coded sphere SD. Now the color source parameters are updated each frame. I've attached a color source to the player character so that it follows us around, and a couple static color sources on these banners, but this can now be any objects in the game that you want to bring color to the world. We can also see that we get a smooth blend between overlapping color sources for free, and that's thanks to our color SDF using the minimum distance between all color spheres. And that's the basics, but there's a lot we can do to improve this effect. Since this is all working off SDFs, you can go crazy with the shapes, you don't necessarily have to stick with spheres. You can also animate the properties. Here I'm animating the sphere radius to expand and contract as the color grows and decays, and you could even introduce noise to the shapes so you have a more organic effect, as if it's growing through the environment like you see here in the larger color sources in Farewell North. For the most complicated and dynamic shapes, like the canoe wake and the snow melting, I actually implemented those in a completely different way. Instead of representing these as SDFs, these color sources are rendered separately as particles to a hidden off-screen texture. You sample it and use its red channel as the color strength at the current position, where black is uncolored and red is colored. The player also has the ability to create a burst of fleeting color around them, and this is implemented in yet another unique way. This particular effect is meant to work in view space rather than world space, meaning it doesn't matter how far away the pixel is, only whether it's visible through the hidden sphere around you. I do this by calculating a line from the camera to the pixel being colored, and checking if that line intersects the sphere around the player. If an intersection is found, then the pixel is colored, otherwise it's uncolored. I could go on, and there's really so much you can do to build off this core premise, and to tailor the effect to suit your game. If you'd like to use my code as a starting point, then I've made this Godot project available on my Patreon, and I'll leave the link below. In terms of performance, the basic effect is quite lightweight, even if you have dozens of color sources. In Feral North, I did incorporate a few general optimizations that are worth calling out though. One is in the color manager. I implemented Frustum Culling to filter out color sources that aren't in the camera's field of view. We know if a pixel is outside of the camera Frustum, then it's going to be clipped by the GPU anyways, so there's really no situation where we need to know about non-visible color sources in the shaders. There are a whole lot of sheep here, each with their own color source, so it's worth filtering out any outside the camera Frustum before sending all that data to the GPU. The other is definitely overkill unless you've got hundreds or thousands of color sources, but I did implement it in Farewell North, and it's in the final build, so let me explain. I calculate a bounding sphere around all the active color sources. Since this bounding sphere encapsulates all the color sources, it's impossible for a pixel to be colored if it's not also inside the bounding sphere, allowing us to completely bypass the checks on each individual color source. Keep in mind that in Feral North, there are a lot of additional features on top of the color effect, including a few texture samples, and this effect had to be implemented in additional shader passes for depth normals, shadow casting, and so on, so the total cost of the effect with that added complexity starts to become a bit more substantial than the basic implementation in our Godot project. So this allowed me to filter out all those operations for large chunks of the screen on average. You definitely do not need these optimizations at this stage, I just bring them up to give you some ideas if you really lean into this effect and make it a substantial part of your game. So hopefully that gives you the confidence to get started with a similar effect, and if you want to pick up where I left off, then you can always grab the Godot project on my Patreon. Speaking of which, thank you to all my patrons who directly support my game dev journey. An extra special thank you to my magpies, and my Osprey supporters Elegon, Purple Slaw Studio, Jason Hansen, Ellie Swaley, Raven Painted, Justice Lind, and Oliver Murhouse. Make sure you check out Skillshare using the link below, and I will see you in the next one.